Good morning. And those of you that are at home, let's also just prepare our hearts even as we come to worship the Lord this morning. Parents, can you also just kindly prepare the materials for the children? And even as we come together, let's take some time to be still before the Lord and just sense His presence. And this morning, we have two children, Siobhan and Christy Chen, who will be reading to us from the book of Psalms, chapter 145. Let's listen to the word of God together, even as we prepare to worship Him.
Good morning, church.
Good morning, church.
Today we will be reading Psalm 145. I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness.
The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love.
The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all He has made. All your works praise you, Lord. Your faithful people extol you. They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might, so that all peoples may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations.
The Lord is trustworthy in all He promises and faithful in all He does. The Lord upholds all who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing.
The Lord is righteous in all His ways and faithful in all He does. The Lord is near to all who call on Him, to all who call on Him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear Him. He hears their cry and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love Him, but all the wicked He will destroy.
My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Let every creature praise His holy name forever and ever. Here ends the reading.
Thank you.
Very good morning. Welcome to all of you, whether you are in person or joining us online. Let's rise, even as we come this morning, to acknowledge the presence of God, that even as we come as His people, we have entered into His presence and sanctuary to worship Him. Can we just stand, even as we invite His presence here this morning? Come, let's pray. Lord, even as we come this morning, we thank you that this is the day that you have made, and we will be glad and rejoice in it. We want to thank you for your goodness and faithfulness. We also want to thank you that together as a community, we can come united in worship of Jesus as our Lord, King, and Savior. That this morning as we come, unite our hearts, we pray, whether we are in person here or joining in from our respective homes, we pray, Lord, that our eyes and our hearts will just be attuned even unto you. Remind us again and again that worship is for you and you alone. And therefore, we pray that this morning, as we offer up our worship as well as praises, Lord, we pray that it will be acceptable to you. Be exalted, be lifted up, even in the midst of your people. And we come, Lord, with a heart of thanksgiving and gratitude. Lord, we bless you. We exalt you. And even as we come this morning, we pray that you will receive, Lord, this, our worship, that will be worthy to you and you alone. We want to just give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Over to you. Worship.
Good morning, church. Those who are here in the sanctuary, it's good to see all of you. And I see more people this Sunday. And those of you at home, good morning. And I want you guys to make a little bit space, whether you're here or you're at home, because the first two songs is going to be quite jang, jang, jang. So get ready to do some exercise this morning, and we praise the Lord, yeah? And I'm glad that the children read this morning, Psalms 145. Let me just repeat verse 1 and verse 2. I will exalt you, O my God and King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and exalt your name forever and ever. So come church this morning. Let us praise and worship our God who has done great things in our lives. Let us just lift our voice to him this morning, yeah? Great things.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You
the King who conquered the grave.
you've done for me.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father Lord. Thank you, Father Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. We continue to declare that, Lord, you are God of God. Let us declare together Psalms 136, verses 1 to 4. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. His love endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, his love endures forever. Let's repeat verse 3. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. His love endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, his love endures forever. Hallelujah. To the Lord, our God and King, his love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With my hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing. Amen. Amen. Pass the time now for intercession.
Good morning, SSMC Church. I am honored to be here today to shed some light on the unreached people group of the South Kiziga people of Cameroon. Let us learn more about this people group before we pray for them. Before we begin, I have a quick and simple activity for all of us. Can you identify or guess which continent the country Cameroon is in? Let's take a few seconds. Cameroon is a country located in Africa. Can you figure out which part of Africa Cameroon is in? Cameroon is a Central African country that is located next to the ocean. The South Kiziga, contrary to its name, can be found in the northern parts of Cameroon. Here is some information about the South Kiziga from Joshua Project's website. There are a number of items here, but I would like to bring to your attention a couple of information specifically. We see that there is about 140,000 South Kiziga people. Their primary religion are ethnic religions, which is defined as religions which are related to a particular ethnic group. We thank God for the 5% of believers, which make up about 7,000 Christians, and also that there is a complete Bible and various Christian resources made available in their language. Yet, there has not been significant progress in sharing the good news among the South Kiziga people. Why is this so? One of the main challenges is that majority of the population have ethnic religions. The South Kiziga people believe in a single God who is the creator of all things, and they believe that God only intervenes when order is disturbed. They also pray to God through their ancestors. With all the information we know so far, let us firstly pray that God's kingdom will be advanced among the South Kiziga people of Cameroon. Let us pray for spiritual strongholds to be brought down, and that their belief in a creator God would be a bridge to spiritual truth. Furthermore, let us pray that the church in Cameroon will rise up. We want to pray for continued boldness for God's people to share the good news of Jesus, that they may be equipped with both the Word of God and the love of God to bring others to Christ. Let us also continue to pray that God will increase the laborers in the harvest fields of Cameroon. Dear Church, let us pray for the South Giziga people together. Heavenly Father, we pray for the South Giziga people group. We know that you love them dearly and desire for them to come into the knowledge of the truth. We pray against any power of darkness, rebellion, and evil that is working in the land, and that your marvelous light may shine on the land and on the peoples of this land. We praise you because you are the Creator God, the God of heaven and earth. Even the South Giziga people know this. We pray, Lord, that you will reveal yourself to the people of South Giziga, so that they may know and proclaim too that you are the God of the universe. We also pray for your people in Cameroon. May you increase the laborers who are working in your harvest field. Send forth your word through your servants in the land. Embolden, strengthen, and equip your people to know you and make you known. We pray for more of the South Giziga people to have access to the available gospel materials, and also the spiritual hunger and appetite to take these resources seriously. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen. When we enter a time of worship now, I'd like you to stay seated. Those at home, you also may be remain seated. And even as we learn to take time to sit at the feet of Jesus, whenever you are ready, you may stand or you may kneel in whatever form to just come to the Lord's presence and to worship Him this morning. Let's take time to wait upon the Lord.
Let's take time to wait upon the Lord. Let's take time to listen to His voice. Unless the
prepare your hearts to receive from Him this morning. I'm sure you have gone through many storms in your life, but yet as we sing this morning, our God is a faithful God. His love endures forever. So come, church, let's take time and listen to what He wants to speak to us this morning. So let's take time to wait upon the Lord. Let's take time to listen to His voice. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain. So let's take time to wait upon the Lord. Let's take time to wait upon the Lord. Let's take time to feed upon His word. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain. So let's take time to wait upon the
fulfill in us all Your purpose. till your church is filled and the earth is filled with your glory.
Church, let's stand and sing verse 3 together.
Amen. Please be seated. Thank you, worship team. Welcome again. This morning, I have the privilege to introduce our speaker, Dr. Tan Su In. I know his heart is to be with us here this morning. And I will just give a very brief introduction. He's actually on Zoom, live Zoom, from Singapore this morning. About sometime mid last year, while we were praying and seeking the Lord for the direction of the church, one of the things that God impressed upon my heart and the hearts of the leaders is this whole area of discipleship. And well, some of us may say coincidence, but I would want to say that, you know, as God begins to show, God also begins to connect with resources and people. And I'm just so glad that, you know, as we are praying, I was asking the Lord, you have to show us or connect us with resources that will be able to encourage, help us to move along this trajectory. And it was sometime in September, I first came across a video recording of Dr. Tan. He was speaking about the theological basis of spiritual mentoring. And lo and behold, sometime in November, not by choice, I ended up in his class. And I think that was the first time I interacted with Dr. Tan. But in the course of that interaction, as we begin to share what is in our hearts, you know, like some people say, ngam ngam, you know, it's like it resonates in both of our hearts. What are some of the things that we sense and feel that God is saying to each one of us and to His church? And therefore, today we have Dr. Tan with us, and I know many of us here, we have interacted with him over 4 sessions on spiritual mentoring. And therefore, without further ado, can we just extend our warm as well as welcome to Dr. Tan, even as he brings and speaks to us from Singapore. Over to you, Dr. Tan.
Good morning, dear friends. I was telling Pastor Robin that I was slightly intimidated to be ministering with SSMC. As a young pastor in PJ a long time ago, in the old First Baptist, I've always known SSMC to be led by some of God's choicest leaders, very committed to missions, innovative ministry, and although he told me not to be, but I was a bit intimidated to be ministering with SSMC. But as time went by, I also realized that there are a number of very old friends in SSMC whom I haven't seen for years. And that gave me great joy. And indeed, it is true. I wish I was there to be able to meet up with some of them. But I think that should come soon with the opening of travel. But in the meantime, I'm just glad that I'm able to connect with you through technology, you know, through Zoom. And I really love that last song we sang. It's one of my favorites. It's a cry to God to speak to us. And so let us begin with a word of prayer. Lord, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. And Lord, as your children, we now wait expectantly upon you. Abba, Father, come and feed us with the living word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If I were to go to any group in any church and ask, how many of you are Christian? I got most people put up hand. But if I were to ask how many are disciples, I think some not quite sure. Maybe your church will score better on this. But I think for the longest time, we have been, and I would say even crippled by this understanding that there are two tiers of believers. There are those who have accepted Christ, and those days there will be some kind of evangelistic service. If you die tonight, you know where you go or not. And then there will be pictures of clouds up there and fire down there. And then if you die tonight, you make sure you go to the right place. So of course I want to go to the right place. I would say the sinner's prayer, sign on the dotted line. I'm a Christian. Then later they come back to you and said, but if you're serious about your faith, you must become a disciple, a follower of Jesus. And then that means you have to memorize 500 Bible verses, talk to strangers in the street with the gospel, do quiet time at least 6 days a week, 7 days you're rushing to church. So you have to do all these kind of things that mark you out as a disciple. And there's the rest of us, and there's a disciple. And the point being that it is a choice whether you're a disciple or not. Even if you don't become a disciple, your cosmic life insurance, you will go to heaven when you die. But to follow Jesus on this earth fully as a disciple is a choice. So some of us may respond to this call, some of us may not. And yet there will be many people who, of course, this sounds quite scary, so it's okay, no? I just go to church, I give my tithe and offering, all that, I'm fine. I take part in some of the church programs, but disciple, I think that one a bit too hard, lah. So for years, I think many people go through life, and many churches have this two-tier approach, which I think has crippled the church from being what it should be. I really believe that all of us are called to be disciples. And therefore, I want to revisit this famous passage at the end of the book of Matthew. So please bear with me because I'm sure you've heard many, many, many sermons on this already, the Great Commission. So today you get one more. I think often Christian teaching is not learning a lot of new things, but being reminded of what we already know and what we need to internalize further. Now, often in this knowledge time, people want to learn new things or that. But sometimes it's being reminded of what we should know and how that should be more internalized in us. So bear with me as I revisit this famous passage at the end of the Gospel of Matthew. I will just read through the passage and just comment on it. So I'm now famous for the one who has no PowerPoint one. No PowerPoint. And I just really pray that the points got power. You have to pray with me. But I'm one of those no PowerPoint. Every time I go to preach in the church, got PowerPoint? I feel almost embarrassed. No. But I'm hoping God will speak through His word. And this is what I hope to do. If you have your Bibles with you, let's look at this passage in Matthew 28, verse 16 onwards. I'll just go through line by line and see what the Lord may speak to us. So verse 16, then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. So the number 11 here, already a bit sad, right? Should be how many? Should be 12, right? But already Judas is not in the picture. And if anything, it reminds us that following Jesus is a choice, lah. You want to follow Jesus or not? I know that salvation is by grace from beginning to end, but along the way, it also entails a decision to take up my cross and follow Jesus. So have you made that choice at some point in your life? Because this is not something that Christ is going to force on you. He gives you everything needed for this new life, but at some point a response is called for, and this 11 people responded to Christ and went to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. Now, you may or may not know that actually mountain is a very important word. You didn't know, huh? We know that God is everywhere. Mountain la, valley, sea la, mana mana, He's everywhere. But whenever God wants to give you a special revelation, He will ask you go mountain. Remember Mount Sinai, the Ten Commandments? You remember the Mount of Transfiguration? So whenever God says mountain, oh, something very important is about to be revealed. That's the significance of mountain. I remember when, a long time ago, in Form 3, I had a maths teacher, and I tell you, to be a teacher in a boys' school, really, you have to take anti-high blood pressure tablets. So all the guys will be in class, we'll be arm wrestling, whatever. So whenever the maths teacher wants to get our attention, he will say, what I'm going to teach today is a foundational lesson. Well, suddenly everybody in the class will pay attention. Because we know the code word, foundational lesson means coming out in the exam. So everybody now take notes of that. So it got our attention. And when you see mountain, God is saying, this, you take special care. What is about to be revealed is of special significance. So he went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. Now this is Jesus initiating this, telling us what's going to happen. So they all went to the mountain, went to the mountain, and when they saw Jesus, they worshipped Him, but some doubted. Now, worship means the complete offering of your life unto Him. See, nowadays, often, and maybe this is just our language, worship seems to be equivalent to singing songs. Let's prepare to worship God, means kita akan nyanyi, and we're going to sing songs unto the Lord. And of course, this is part of worship. I think God has given us the gift of music, and music is a powerful means to express what is deepest in our heart. So I'm not against worshiping God with song, as long as we realize that worshiping God is more than song, lah. That really we are to offer the totality of our lives unto Him. So when we see the disciples worshiping Jesus, they were submitting their whole lives unto Him. Probably they were kneeling down as well. Often I say, the worship on Sunday prepares us for the worship on Monday. You know, if you have actually encountered God on Sunday, then I see the proof is how we live for God on Monday to Saturday. Whether we are worshiping God with the totality of our lives. We know we need God's help, we fumble, all that, but as long as we realize that worship is like offering our lives as a living sacrifice, you remember in Romans 12? Bukan nyanyi saja, it's not just singing songs. So I'm always a bit worried about this, that we reduce worship purely to singing. It's part of worship, but worship is much more than that. Worship is giving unto the Lord the living sacrifice of the totality of our lives. And really a good, powerful corporate worship like what we had this morning helps us to do that. I'm not against that at all. It's very powerful that we encounter God in song and scripture and prayer, as long as we remember that we continue to worship after we leave the hall. We're still worshiping the rest of the week. So these 11 disciples went and they worshipped Him, which we have read so many times, that it doesn't shock us anymore. But you must remember, these 11 fellas were all Jews. They were all Jews. And that means they have learned from young there's only one God. No one, don't let anyone say that we worship three gods, but only one God. In fact, coming from a Jewish background, there were some points of their history, even the danger of being stoned to death for any kind of idolatry. Only one God, Yahweh. And now these fellas who grew up in this context, the nearest equivalent I can think of is our Muslim friends. Only one God. Yeah? Then they were worshipping Jesus. This ex-carpenter, itinerant preacher, and they were worshipping Him, probably kneeling down and giving their lives to Him. Why? Why do 11 Jews who believe only in one God go and worship this fellow? Something must have happened. This is a major paradigm shift. It's not a small thing. It is small to us only because we have read this so often, it don't shock us anymore. But this is a major shock. That 11 Jews are worshipping someone who is not just the Yahweh that they know from the temple. This is actually an individual who moved among them. So why? This is a very important question. Why did they choose to worship Jesus? And that's why it's important to read the Bible in totality, because the chapters before that talks about Jesus' death and resurrection. I mean, anybody can claim to be Messiah, but not everybody can die and rise again. You know anybody who die and rise again, you should let me know. But so anybody can claim I'm Messiah, but not everybody can die and rise again. And that's on the basis of the fact that they knew this Jesus who lived among them. He was crucified and buried, and he rose again from the dead. Don't tell me 11 Jews so easily get conned by, people die and rise again. But these are all 11 hardened people, fishermen, ex-tax collectors. All that. They're not people easily conned. Something must have shifted their mind and their paradigm, and that is the resurrection of Christ. That's why at the end of Lent, our Good Friday and Easter is so critical, because our faith is not just a bunch of ideas. It is based on something that really happened. It is based on history, on Jesus who died and rose again. That's why every Easter, I enjoy preaching on the resurrection and the reasons for the resurrection. It's very personal to me as well, because in my final year of dental school, in my first life, I was a dentist. In my final year of dental school, the Lord said, He wants me to be a pastor. Wow, only about 6 months away, already dentist, already. Then he called me to be pastor. I actually did graduate and worked for some years, but that was a critical moment in my life. I came from a small Peranakan family in Penang, just my younger sister and myself. And for in those days, Peranakan family, you have only one son. You don't have dreams that he be a pastor. But, so maybe you got 10 sons, 9 become doctor, and then maybe the one of them who's grades not so good, maybe become pastor. But you don't have one guy and then he want him to be pastor. So I knew that if I were to move from dentistry to be a pastor, it would disappoint my parents. My parents are not rich. My father was a clerk in those days, not admin assistant, clerk. And they were all lower middle class. They have sacrificed so much to see me through dental school. I didn't want to disappoint them. Now suddenly following Jesus means doing something that would cost me something. I love my parents. I don't want to disappoint them. So for a number of months, I began to grapple. This Christian thing, real or not? Because I was second generation. My parents were Christian, but I was second generation. So I never paid a price to follow Christ. But now suddenly, to follow Christ, and if God is real, then I have to give up dentistry to be a pastor. So again, I said I practiced for 3 years because I wanted, as a pastor, to know what working life was like. But that's a different point. So I grappled for months. I didn't tell anybody. Just grappled. And I realized that for me, as I grappled through the issues, the evidence for the resurrection was very powerful. That this guy really died and rose again. And therefore, whatever he called me to do, I got to do. So why do 11 Jews suddenly go and worship this Jesus fellow? Because Jesus died and rose again. And do you know why you want to follow Christ? Because I tell you, Christianity is not the easiest faith. If you want, there are many other easier faiths out there. You can DIY your own faith or whatever. But you want to follow Jesus. Sooner or later, it's going to cost you something. You got to be sure that this is the real thing. The reason why I follow Christ is not because it's easy but because it's true. So I don't know about you. But what is more interesting is they say that some doubted. In verse 17, some doubted. Some doubted. This is incredible, because if I'm writing a propaganda tract, I wouldn't put some doubted. I would say that, everybody understood exactly who Jesus is. No? But, some doubted. So clearly, this is not some propaganda tract where you write everything sui-sui. It's clearly an accurate account. And the writer tells us that even though they worship Jesus, some doubted. Now, I want to be clear that the word here is not unbelief. Unbelief got no chance really. Disbelief, unbelief, no chance. So that means they still believe, but they had questions. They doubted. This has the ring of truth, because all their life they worship one God. Now this fellow died and rose again, so I think he is who he claims to be. Then I still have questions about what this is all about, because this is a major change. So this has the ring of truth. Some doubted. And sometimes I wonder whether our churches allow people to have doubts or not. Do we allow people to have questions or not? Sometimes we panic. People say, they got questions. Wait. I was going to say read Rabbi Zacharias, but maybe they're not so hot now. Read Lee Strobel or read C.S. Lewis, but because it's not something that we want to encounter people having doubts. But if your church has many second or third generation Christians, I think we should give the space for people to ask questions. I believe there are answers. I'm not scared. But we don't want to squash people having questions. And even in the Bible, we are told some doubted. These are people who worship Christ, but they had serious questions. And I think that's fair. It's not that we want people to be like that, but no, this following Christ is a big thing, Lee. Big picture, I believe in Jesus, but man, I still got questions here and there. And I'm hoping that as the church ministers to second, third generation Christians, or even to non-Christians, sometimes the questions are the same. That we have loving, humble, but clear answers. But it begins with allowing people to have doubts, or should I say to have questions. It's not disbelief, it's not unbelief. Unbelief means you walk away, there's nothing to talk about. They worship, but they doubted. Then Jesus, verse 18, Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." So they came, they saw Jesus, then Jesus came to them. Very strange, should be they go to Jesus right now. The boss is there, the disciples come to the boss, but instead Jesus had to go to them. That means they were bowing there and dare not come near to him. So Jesus has to go near to them because they dare not come near to him. Now, Jesus came to them. They didn't come to Jesus. They must have come to some point, kneel down, worship him, but they stopped there. They're not near him. So Jesus has to come to them. And you have to wonder, why didn't they come? Remember Mary, what, going to grab him, worship him, but they're not going near. They stand at some distance, although they worship him. My theory is this, because when was the last time that the disciples saw Jesus? When Jesus was being captured and they all chabot, right? They all deserted him. At the time when he needed his friends the most, all these guys all ran away. The ladies didn't run away. Sisters, the ladies all watch and they never run away. But the guys, die also, I will never desert you. When soldiers come, poof, chabot. So now, their last memory is deserting Jesus. Sekarang, they find that Jesus actually rose from the dead. Oh, my goodness, he really is Lord and God. Wow. Sure, he's going to mara us already. Sure, mara already. We deserted him. He's going to come to us. When I needed you, you all desert me. So you're all scared. They're not approach Jesus. Well, sure, kena mara. They're all scared. So they dare not approach him. Understandably, because their last encounter with him, they deserted him at this time and he needed them the most. They all chow. So now, hey, the fellow really came back from the dead. He's really the Messiah. Well, die. He's sure kind of scholars, really. So they dare not approach him. But Jesus approached them to let them know that he forgives them and accepts them. In fact, calling them to go to Galilee in verse 16 is already very significant. Because Galilee is where they started their public ministry. To go back to Galilee, meaning let's reboot and start again. To go back to Galilee is to start again, start afresh. You all fumble, but never mind. I forgive you. Let's go and start again. That's what it means when Jesus approached them. That's what it means when Jesus said, let's go to Galilee. Galilee is where we started. So much things have happened, fumble, all that. But hey, let's reboot and start again. I don't know about you. I have fumbled big time in my own life. I fumbled big time. I need a God who tells me, let's go to Galilee. I desperately need a God who tells me to go to Galilee. Do you need a God like that? Have there been times when you fumble in your life? And God says, no, you must of course come back to God. We cannot run away like Judas. You must come back to God. But God says, I forgive you. Let's start again. Maybe some of you this morning at home in the church auditorium may need to hear this. Maybe we fumble in ways nobody knows. We are very good at hiding things. We are very ashamed or we are convicted of sin. And we come to Jesus and Jesus comes to us. And says, I forgive you. Let's go Galilee. Let's start again. It's okay. Let's reboot. I needed a God like that. Otherwise, I got no chance. I needed a God like that. He came to them and said, all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. So all authority, heaven on earth means kesemuanya. All authority, not half authority, three-quarter authority, all authority. And heaven and earth means everything, everywhere. Everywhere, Jesus has all authority. Kesemua, everywhere, Jesus is Lord and God and has sovereign authority. Some of the songs we sang this morning established that as well. There's so many things going wrong in the world. Myanmar, Ukraine, everywhere, and sometimes it gets very disturbing, but we want to remember today that God is King everywhere. God is on His throne. All authority on heaven and earth has been given to me. In fact, you remember in the temptation story, Satan said, you bow down and worship me, I give you all the kingdoms on earth. Remember, I don't know whether you can give or not, but that was his offer. You know, you worship me, I'll give you all the kingdoms on earth. Tapi Jesus didn't give in to temptation. He followed God all the way, even to the cross. And he get not just earth, but heaven juga, heaven and earth. So when the enemy comes to us with temptation, sometimes it's really very attractive. But we hold out to God's promises. We say no to the enemy. And sometimes the temptations are very subtle. But Jesus, you have all the kingdoms on earth, then you only go to the cross. Sometimes the temptations are very subtle, but we want to be clear, we follow God all the way. And then at the end of the day, we get heaven and earth. That's what Jesus, we get everything that God wants to give us. So let's not give in to temptation. So all authority, heaven and earth, has been given to me because of His complete faithful sacrifice. So authority basically means that we have to submit to Him. This is the meaning of authority. Someone has authority over me. Apa He asked me to do, I must do. That is the meaning of authority. So you say that Jesus has authority over you, then whatever He tells you to do, you must do. If you don't do, then it means that you don't believe His authority. I'm sorry, but that's the way, that's what authority works. So He says, if you really submit to my authority, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. But this one, you all probably memorized already or whatever. But say, if you are really someone who believes in Jesus' authority, something the Lord has been telling your church in recent times, go and make disciples. It doesn't say go and make converts and hopefully some percentage become disciples. Go and make disciples. The problem is that we have believed that disciple means super Christian, but that's not the meaning. Disciple means apprentice. It means learner. To be a Christian is to learn from Jesus what it means to be truly alive. He is our teacher. He's our mentor. And so we talk about mentoring, capital M, yalah Jesus. He will teach us what it means to be truly human, truly alive. That's what disciple means. It doesn't mean super Christian. It means someone who is committed to follow Jesus so that He can shape us to be like Him. A student fully formed will be like his master, Luke, remember. So it's not making disciples then, and then as something extra to following Jesus. I think the call, and we know it's by grace. It's not that we obey God, then we get saved. That's not the point. We are saved by grace from beginning to end. But we are saved so that we can be people who follow Jesus, to be shaped by Him, to be truly human. Jesus comes to us as human 2.0. Adam, the first one, corrupted by sin. Now, Jesus shows us what it means to be truly human, what God had in mind when He created us. We are meant to be learners from Christ, how to be truly human. And this is a call to reach out to all nations, which means all peoples. That alone tells us that Christians can never be into racism. God's love is for every community. Make disciples of all nations, which can be translated all peoples. Of course, the whole Church of Christ, we all will reach different people perhaps, but your church, just now you prayed for this group in Cameroon. That really impressed me because many churches only pray for themselves, pray for the people around them. But your concern for God's heart, you even pray for people in Cameroon. And this is one way that you're obeying this commandment to make disciples of all peoples. No, not just your type of people, no, all people. And in Malaysia, we have every chance to do this. Who are the communities in Malaysia? Some easier to reach than others, Saitau. But then the command from God is to make disciples of all peoples. So how to make disciples? There are two steps. So this one coming out in the exam. The two steps of making disciples. Number one, ialah to baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So the recruitment, hey, you want to be a follower of Jesus? You sure are not? Okay, you want to show me that you really want to be a follower of Jesus? Water baptism. Often I hear people say, oh, no, I'm not mature enough yet to be baptized. But I say, tapi baptism bukan a sign of maturity. It's a sign that you're beginning. You're beginning your journey with Christ. So how many of you here already are Christian but belum baptized? Talk to your pastor. Because baptism is not a sign of maturity. It's a sign that I sumpah I will follow Jesus. It's a public declaration that I will follow Jesus. We are saved by grace, yes, but grace has to be demonstrated. You want to show people that you really are a follower of Jesus. Nowadays, people think that you follow Jesus where you PRC. You know? Hey, last night, an evangelistic meeting, how many PRC? Not People's Republic of China. PRC, yala, pray to receive Christ. So for the longest time, last night, 60 people PRC. But nothing wrong with PRC, pray to receive Christ, but the God-given biblical way of showing, you have to take the plunge. Of course, you're Methodist, so can be sprinkled also. You have to take the plunge that you are follower of Jesus. Publicly say, I belong to the Lord. It's a declaration before God, before people, before the spirit world. I am a follower of Jesus. So to start the journey of being a disciple, number one, yala, be baptized. And baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Now I tell you, if I'm a English teacher, I will fail Jesus. Fail. Because in the name, satu nama. In the name, satu nama. Then he give you three names, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Apa ni? Salah. Satu nama saja. Name. Singular. Then you get three for them. It's this wonderful reality of the real God who really is one God. Don't let anyone say we worship three gods. But this one God, it's one and yet got three persons. After all these years as a Christian, you ask me to explain, I still got a headache. One, three. Sometimes I think I give up trying to rationalize it. I just kneel and worship. The human mind can only go so far. A God who is one yet three. There's a way to humble us. So sometimes I give up trying to explain the physics of it. I just kneel down and worship. This is how God has revealed himself as one God, yet three persons. And then the second part, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. So once you begin your journey is to show that you follow Jesus through water baptism, and then the rest of your life is shaped by the word of God, teaching them to obey everything. Bukan teaching them, full stop, teaching them to obey. No? So it's a life shaped by the word of God. And I need to say this because so much of our education, we have a lot of information, tapi it doesn't form us. Information, bukan formation. Information. And we all study for exam, maybe now different. Last study for exam, then we exam come, O-level, A-level, no, SPM, STPM, or whatever. We regurgitate all that we studied. Blah, 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 blah. Then after exam over, we give back to teacher. That we don't take responsibility for what we have learned. And sometimes we bring that into our Bible study, must, especially small group, if it's purely Bible study, purely content saja, without seeking to obey, seeking to let the word shape us, then this is not what God had in mind. To start your journey as a disciple, water baptism, the rest of your days until you see Jesus face to face, a life that is shaped by the word. Not just the sini saja, but a word that will shape you to become a certain kind of people, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. Not only certain parts only, In the long run, we need to know the full counsel of God and to be shaped by it, not just to know it. And then the last, and Jesus gives a promise, surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. It's a reminder to us that making disciples, well, indeed becoming a disciple, it cannot be done in human strength. Tak boleh. Some people either don't do discipleship, or they think they can do discipleship by human effort. Both also salah. We are called to be Jesus. We called to be following Jesus as disciples. We are called to make disciples. But this is something only God can empower us to do. So when Jesus tells you to be a disciple first, of course, be disciple first, then make disciple, it has to be in His power. So Jesus doesn't say, you all go and try. I go back, chill for a while. You all go and try and then tell me what happened. But Jesus says, I am with you. He's in the game. His skin is in the game. He is actually there with you as you try to grow in Christ-likeness, as you try to help other people. The Almighty God, the God who parted the Red Sea, the God who died and rose again, that Jesus is with us to empower us. And that is why we celebrate the presence of the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of Christ in our churches. Often we talk about the Holy Spirit only in terms of signs and wonders, which is correct. And we pray for more manifestation of God's power. But the number one job of the Holy Spirit is to empower us to be a different kind of person. to say no to sin, to say yes to the things of God. And really, I cannot be just another sermon on discipleship, which only gives you more things that I haven't done. I feel even more lousy. You know? As much as I confront myself, you know, I'm preaching this loudly because I'm speaking to myself, Dulu. For all of us, it is a call to follow Jesus and to help people follow Jesus in the power of Christ. I am with you to the end of the age. I'm not somewhere from a distance, but here I'm actually with you to the end of the age. So Christ is with us to help us be followers of Him and to help us make disciples of all peoples. So as I know that this COVID period has been very difficult and disruptive and continues to cause a lot of damage. But it also forces us as a church to step back and to revisit, what does it mean to be a disciple, what it means to be God's people. And that shouldn't be wasted. And I think the Lord has spoken to you long before this morning, that to return to the commitment to be Christ-like people. And that's what the world needs, not just politics or armaments or whatever. They need to have hope that there is a reality of a new beginning. And they will see this in the lives of God's people. So we have to be differentiated from people who do not know Jesus. We have to learn from Christ what it means to be truly human. And I pray, and I pray, and I pray that God will do a fresh and powerful work in SSMC. That all of you will rise up and say, we want to be what God wants us to be. And shine as light in the darkness. Can we do that? Boleh? Let me pray in closing. Father, our lives were very noisy, very running here and there. And now in this COVID, we have been forced to step back and to discern again. Father, I thank you for the history of SSMC. What you have done in them and through them is a powerful testimony. But Lord, the journey continues until you return. And at every chapter of the journey, we want to ask you again, what do you want us to be and what do you want us to do? And I pray, oh Lord, you speak clearly to my dear friends, that they will have confidence and joy looking forward to the exciting times now and in the days ahead, where they will rise up to be your people and shine as light in the darkness. For I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dr. Tan, for sharing the word with us this morning. Can I just suggest that, for all of us who are listening this morning, just spend some time in quietness and respond to the challenge, to the encouragement, even from His word this morning, that all of us are called to be disciples. And I think Dr. Tan made that one point, is that God is not asking for perfection, but God is asking us to come to Him and begin with what we have, not what we don't have, and to begin that journey with Him. Can I just also invite the worship team to lead us even in this song? Let's worship the Lord. Let's recommit ourselves to Him.
We will finish the race by the good fight. on the plow, never turning back, bringing strongholds to naught. His kingdom advance in the power and might of His Spirit. We will press on toward the goal, for the price of our high calling in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
The promise to His own, the ones who know their God, strong and through His mighty words, God ever by your side, boldly we forge ahead, no ground too hard to break, knowing well that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. We will finish the race, find the good on the plow, never turning back, bringing strongholds to naught. His kingdom advance in the power and might of His Spirit. We will press on toward the goal, for the price of our high calling in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Let's declare.
His kingdom advance in the power and might of His Spirit. We will press on toward the goal, for the price of our high calling in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
We will press on toward the goal,
for the price of our high
Why don't we just lift our hands even to Him? Lord, even as we lift our hands to You, it is to say, Lord, we surrender to You. It is also to say, we submit to You. Because You are our Lord, Savior, and King. And even this day, as we receive Your word, we want to just say, help us to obey. Refresh, renew, and empower us with the Holy Spirit. That we'll begin to understand, Lord, that You have so much more for us in our lives. We want to just thank You for this calling to be Your followers, and also that privilege that You have given to us to help others to follow You. And Lord, we want to just pray for us in SS that indeed we will be Your disciples who will also be disciple makers. Help us, we pray, by the power of Your Spirit that is already at work in each one of us. We want to just give thanks because You are able, Lord, to do exceedingly far more abundant than what we can even ask or imagine, according to the power that is already at work in Your church, in each one of us. We want to just commit ourselves to You in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Maybe just a quick note. At the end of our service here, if you want to speak to Dr. Tan, I think there is later a camera there, a phone camera. You can, if you are an old friend of Dr. Tan, you want to just say hello to him. We will give you the opportunity to just do that at the end of our service. Just very quickly this morning, Once again, we want to welcome all of you, and I believe that perhaps this morning we do have more guests, or rather, connections of Su-in, who may be following our service and listening to his sharing this morning. We want to also just welcome you. And if you could just do us the honors, kindly just scan the QR code and leave your details behind, so that if you are local and if you are looking for a church, we also want to connect with you and trust that you will also be part of a faith community in this place. Okay, so please help us, and we want to just thank you in advance. All the announcements with regards to the church activities, you will actually find it on our website. But today, I just want to focus on a few important notices. Now, all of us know that come April 1st, the nation is opening up, and we are transitioning to the endemic phase of the so-called part of the national recovery. So the next slide that I'm going to just share with you are just some SOPs that will be relevant to, firstly, in-person services in church Sunday, and also it will apply to the discipleship group meetings as well as the children church. All right, so later we will share the same slides to all the DGLs for distribution. All right. So and not just the children's church, but also any in-person meeting, whether it's youth meetings or whatever meetings, that as we gradually come back for that physical gathering within the church or in the church premise. So please bear with me just very quickly. These are the SOP. Let me just quickly run through. All right. For in-person meetings, whether it is in church, home fellowship, or even children's church, all adults must be fully vaccinated. All right. Number two, children under 12 years must be supervised by vaccinated adults. Number three, no pre-registration required, meaning that starting from April, you can just come to church. You don't have to register or pre-register. Number four, similarly, the national SOP still requires us to scan MySejahtera. This is applicable when you come to church. Now, if you decide to have home fellowship meetings, all right, unless you want to do a QR code for your house, it's okay. But otherwise, this applies for the church. Number five, everyone is required to wear a mask at all times. And please mask up properly. I think we need to consider one another, the safety of each other. Number six, keep social distancing. Number seven, just a note, no symptoms. In other words, if some of us are not feeling well for whatever reasons, I think because of the current COVID situation, we would request that, you know, please rest and I wouldn't say stay away. For the time being, keep yourself away from, maybe that's not the best word, okay. Stay at home and be rested until you are well, then you can join the in-gathering meetings. Number eight, maintain hand hygiene. Number nine, no meeting. The SOP, we would strongly suggest that even in small group meetings, not to have food. All right. So these are the general SOPs, and we will basically be sending out to all everyone within the church. But whatever it is, we want to strongly encourage that more and more of us should be back Sundays to worship the Lord together. I will just skip the prayer meeting announcement. You can, that is our normal weekly prayer meetings. But I just want to look at this. The Children's Church, starting from April, they will do a rotational kind of a meeting where 1 week of the month, they will meet in person. The next 3 Sundays, it will be online. All right? And what you see here would be the online schedule for the Standard 1 to Standard 4, Standard 5, and Standard 6. So this will be shared to all the parents as well. Please take note. Next Sunday, just a heads up, after service here, request that all ministry heads, DGL, assistant DGLs, and spouses, if you could just stay back. And we want to just have the time of briefing for the DGLs and the ministry head as we move forward in this whole area of what we call establishing mentoring communities. All right, Dr. Tan has helped us in the last 4 weeks journeying with us to explain the theological as well as the practical basis for spiritual mentoring. And for us, we do not just want to hear, but it is also time for us to practically move on together. And therefore, can I just request all those that are relevant, please attend. You would also have received a letter from me. So kindly just respond to the Google Doc. Thank you. Good Friday will be on the 15th, and Easter is on the 17th of next month, April. More information we will be sharing this coming Sunday. However, on the 16th, Saturday, in between Good Friday and Easter Sunday, a group within the church, the worship, as well as the intercessors, they have actually organized what we call Behold the Lamb. This is a 24-hour worship and prayer. We want to encourage full participation of DGs, of families, of individuals to take up 30 minutes time slot from 6 a.m. on the 16th all the way to 6 a.m. on the 17th, a time of just worshiping the Lord. You can be praying, you can also be reading scripture, whatever. So there will be a 30 minutes time slot. And the worship team will be joining us all throughout this 24 hours. So can I just request DGLs as well, mobilize your people to come together, even as we celebrate, even as we remember the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. The BWJ is available. Please take a copy. The physical hard copy is available in the foyer. Children as well. Let's also bring our gifts and offerings to the Lord. So you can bank in online, or you can give your offering on your way out from the sanctuary. Come, let's rise for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above. Heavenly hosts, praise God.
Lord, even as we recognize that this is a season of reset, we also pray, Lord, that you help us to reframe and to re-understand afresh your word for us. And we also pray that as we recommit ourselves to you, the Lord Jesus Christ, that you will redeploy us wherever that we are, that we may be a blessing, that we may be your light and salt, O Lord, that we may also demonstrate what it means to be that renewed humanity through the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you. We are hopeful because it is by your faithfulness you will bring this to pass. You will empower and you will help us. And therefore, even as we have come to worship you this day, dismiss us, not just only with your blessings, but also pour the Father love of God deep into each of our hearts, and also the power of the Holy Spirit to serve you, to worship you, even in this coming week. We want to just give thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 God bless you. See you.